I'm going to take a quick break from poking fun at Marcus Allen's amusing lack of competence on his alleged area of expertise, photography, and have a look at a subject he really does know absolutely nothing about, moon rocks. Let's hear him prognosticate on the subject.
Where is another piece of moon rock you can compare it to and say, yes, it is, no, it isn't? Because NASA, God bless them, if there was a piece of rock that we knew had come from the moon, we could compare the two. Ah, there is. They found it in Antarctica. Wernher von Braun, remember him? He was the chap who designed that bloody great rocket. 365-foot high Saturn V rocket. He was a Nazi, came from Germany. He was responsible for the V2 rockets that landed on London and during the Second War. 1,200 of them landed on London. I had to get out because I was in London at the time. So he built the Saturn V rocket. And for some reason, in 1967, he went on a trip to Antarctica. What? He was supposed to be building rockets, not going to Antarctica. But he went to Antarctica and he brought back a load of rocks. Because if you got something hits the moon hard enough, it will dislodge some surface material, which if it is hit hard enough, it will then escape from the lunar gravity and will be caught by the Earth's gravity and eventually find its way to Earth. And of course, Antarctica is a great place to look for rocks because they're black and you can see them against the snow. The story is that he found a load of rocks in Antarctica. I don't know if that's true or not. I've seen him in Antarctica. That's for real.
Is there a way that they could confirm that, like, that's moon rock that they found in Antarctica as compared to, like, asteroid meteorites? Like, rock from the moon compared to a random asteroid that has meteorites? Like, how do they know that it's from the moon and not from something else, you know, interstellar?
If it was a meteorite that has just landed on Earth because it was wandering through space and thought, oh, look, it's a nice place to land, landed on Earth, it would have what's called a crust on it because it would come in through the Earth's atmosphere quite fast. And the heat of the entry, we'll get onto the heat of entry of the Apollo spacecraft. You've got this rock coming through the Earth's atmosphere, whoa, 40,000 miles an hour, it burns the crust. And that's how you can tell if it's a meteor, I'm told. But you can take the crust off. It's not difficult. Maybe the crust was taken off. Who knows? Which, by the way, you can buy fake moon rock. There are companies that sell it. Put in artificial moon rock and you can do it. That's what Tom Hanks used when he did his From the Earth to the Moon miniseries. He bought several tons of this stuff and spread it out on a studio floor so it looked like the moon.
It's hard to know where to start. Wernher von Braun did indeed go to Antarctica for a few days in January 1967, but there's no evidence at all that he was looking for meteorites or that he brought back any rocks with him. And I wonder if Marcus Allen knows how many meteorites had previously been found in Antarctica by the time of von Braun's visit. There were four. That's right, four. And since these were ordinary chondrites and stony iron meteorites, they were nothing like potential moon rocks. And by the time the Apollo program was finished, only a few more meteorites had been found in Antarctica, and these were found by Japanese geologist-led research expeditions of several months' duration. And the amount they found was absolutely nothing like the 382 kilograms of lunar samples returned by Apollo. And does Marcus Allen really believe that you can strip the fusion crust from a meteorite and present it as a moon rock? Not only would the mechanical process used leave blatant physical traces, but the rock itself would be lacking in any sign of the environment that it had previously been in. Because, you see, Marcus, a rock picked up from the lunar surface will be covered in evidence of exposure to the solar wind and to micrometeoroid bombardment. Geologists are clear that neither of these things can be faked on Earth. The rock will also be covered in lunar regolith, and no, you can't collect that in Antarctica either. Artificial lunar soil is used for testing new rovers, and it's also used on film sets. It's a simulant. It has similar physical and visual properties, but you can't pass it off as actual lunar regolith because its chemistry is totally different. So how do we know that an Apollo moon rock is actually from the moon? Well, we know that it's from somewhere other than Earth because its chemical composition is different to Earth rocks. One example out of many is the concentration of aluminium, magnesium, and iron oxides. Did Marcus say there's nothing to compare Apollo moon rocks with? Well, samples brought back from the moon by unmanned Soviet missions also plot neatly along this line. Lunar rocks and soil contain gases: hydrogen, helium, nitrogen, neon, argon, krypton, and xenon, derived from the solar wind with isotope ratios different than Earth forms of the same gases. The rocks show crystal damage from cosmic rays. Radioisotope examination shows that these rocks are older than any known Earth rocks. The sheer amount and range of samples show that the moon really is the only candidate for the origin of these rocks. And don't forget the 6 foot long intact core tubes as well that were also collected. I wonder if Marcus is aware that the first identification of a meteorite as being of lunar origin was not made until 1982. 10 years after the Apollo program ended. The amount of lunar material found on Earth is still, half a century later, under half the amount brought back by the Apollo missions, and meteorite hunting is a big business these days. I think it's clear that Marcus Allen has absolutely no clue about how closely Apollo samples have been examined. More than 1,000 peer-reviewed papers are published every year. The science and technology involved is so far outside Marcus's experience that you wonder why someone who has made a consistent buffoon of himself in his own alleged field of expertise would have the conceit to even think that he had the qualifications to pass judgment. For a more detailed examination of this issue, please watch Phil Webb's masterly video series on moon rocks. The link is in the description box below.